observe the harf of Quraysh so that they would not confuse themselves. The seven ahruf was revealed, one of Quraysh and six of other dialects was reserved and revealed so that it would make life easy for those who cannot say yu'minun. So if they can say yu'minun, it's easier for them to recite and so on. Some difference here and there. But when this permission, when this form of making life easier became a cause of difference and fitna among them, Uthman said, no, we have to preserve the Quran so that it would not be tampered with. What is the ruling on preserving the Quran on audio format? Now, this is a new compilation of the Quran, and it is needed. You know, no, seriously needed. Because not only audio, we should have also video. Now, we have a chain of reciters, and we have the written form. And it is definitely something to add value to have it in audio by a different number of qaris worldwide to preserve it, and also to have it video, visual. Because, for example, there is something known as al-ishmam. This is something seen, not heard. In Surah Yusuf, Ya abana ma laka la ta'manna. Did you see this? It's like ta'manuna, but it's not heard. Ta'manna. So this is part of the recitation of the Quran. This is the narration. Why are you doing this? This is how it was taught, and it was learned one after the other to the Prophet ﷺ. So what's the ruling? The ruling is preferred and recommended because it adds value. It's not an innovation. It is used to preserve the Quran. What happened to the Mushaf of Abu Bakr, may Allah be pleased with him? We answered this. What is the ruling on changing the pronunciation of the letters of the Quran? Immediately we say this is haram. What do you mean by changing the pronunciation? When someone says, غَيْرِ الْمَغْزُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الظَّالِينَ, this is not Arabic. When people say, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ, الَّذِينَ, what's this? And when you come to a verse like, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ, ظَا in both, no, ضَاد and ظَا. So you have to say, نَاظِرَةٌ and نَاظِرَةٌ. It's different. So what's the ruling on changing the letters, the pronunciation? It's forbidden. What's the ruling on praying behind someone who does this? Well, if the Fatiha is preserved, the rest is okay. But he has to be corrected. If he is unable to correct, someone does not have the ability to say Allazina. He says Allazina. He cannot. It's not that he is lazy or he's sophisticated, high class, Allazina. No, no, no. He does not have the ability to say this. So what's the ruling on this? If you pray behind him and you have the ability, it's not permissible for you to pray behind him. And that is why we always say those who have the Arabic tongue should lead the prayer. Because if he breaks in saying these letters, then my prayer is not valid. I am more some. Now, if he changes the meaning of the Fatiha, Arab or non-Arab, his prayer is void. So if he says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Malik Yawm al-Din, Iyaki Na'bud wa Iyaki Nasta'in. What is the meaning of Iyaki? Female. So instead of saying Iyaka, O Allah, say Iyaki. This is a female. This is what we say for a female when we talk to a female. This is immediately voids the prayer. If someone says Malaka Yawm al-Din, instead of Malik Yawm, it is Malaka. Malaka is the past tense of possessed and owned. So we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Malaka Yawm al-Din. He owned and possessed the Day of Judgment. The meaning is true, but this is not Quran. So immediately his prayer is void. Can we write the Quran in different way to the Uthmanic Mus'haf? Scholars have differed. The majority say, no, it has to be preserved exactly as it reached us. Because there are so many things that are followed. يعني for example, الصلاة in some cases are written with the ta مفتوحة. In other cases, with the ta مربوطة. It should be followed because this is what the companions wrote and we follow it to the letter. Why was it? Of course, this is in the case of writing. Writing what? This is in the case of writing a mushaf, Quran. But if I'm writing, I'm quoting a verse of the Quran, I can write it normally as it is. But in writing the mushaf, the copy of the Quran, I have to follow the same format. Why was it written on one harf? I think this is it, huh? Why was it written on one harf? We said this to avoid the fitna and confusion. Although we agree that seven harfs, it was revealed, we agree that if you recite any of these harfs, you're reciting the Quran that was revealed to Muhammad alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam, but Uthman, may Allah be pleased with him, to avoid the fitna, to avoid the confusion, because it was necessity of that time, he did this and he wrote it on the harf of Quraysh with the possibility to be read with other harf, as we will explain inshallah tomorrow. Wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu sallam baraka al-abdi wa rasulih Nabi Muhammad. I don't think we're going to take much time, maybe only 1 or 2 hours. The names of the surahs. The names of the surahs, was it given by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? Some of it, yes. The Prophet said, you have to recite Al-Zahrawain, Al-Baqarah wa Al-Imran. So we know that he called it Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran. The companion said, I prayed with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam night prayer. He started reciting Al-Baqarah. I say he will bow when it's 100. He continued and he'll finish it. I said, now he's going to bow. And then he started with An-Nisa. And until he finished it. And then he started with Al-Imran. And I almost did something bad. And they told him, what did you want to do? So I wanted to leave him and leave. In one rak'ah, he recited these longest three surahs. So it was known among the companions that these are the surahs with these names. And some of them, we don't have clear opinion or clear hadith that the Prophet called it. So we believe that the names were also given by the companions, some of it. But we cannot classify which from which. Some of the surahs have one name, like Surah Al-An'am, Surah Maryam, Surah Taha. It's known to have only one name. Some surahs have two names, such as Surah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is also known as Surah Al-Qital, because Allah tells us what to do with the kuffar, if we capture them, if we tie them up, whether we kill them, whether we take ransom. So it's called Surah Al-Qital. And other surahs have more than two names, such as Surah At-Tawbah, Surah Al-Fadiha, Surah Bara'ah. These are all names of At-Tawbah and other names. And Surah Al-Fatiha, Umm Al-Kitab, Umm Al-Quran, Al-Shifa, Al-Ruqya, and so on. That was quick. Okay. What about the arrangement of the surahs? To have the Fatiha in the beginning, then Al-Baqarah. Some say we should put it in accordance to what was revealed first. So we should put Surah Al-Alaq in the beginning. And then what's after that, Al-Muddathir. And then Al-Muzzammil. And then and so on so. So can we do this nowadays? No. We have to keep the order as it is. Was the order prescribed by our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? Yes. Who says no? Is what? Not sure. Okay. This is safe. Because you can go both ways. This is the right answer. There are two opinions. Some scholars say it was ordered by the Prophet ﷺ to have this order. Others say no. This is something that the companions came up with. And both case, it doesn't have great value. Someone says, yes, it does, Sheikh. Because if the Prophet put this order, means that we cannot recite in the first surah, some surah, in the first rak'ah, a surah from the bottom and then go to the top. So what is the ruling? The ruling is, the Prophet, as I mentioned in the hadith of Ibn Mas'ud, I think, or Abu Hudhayfa or whatever, he prayed the first rak'ah with the Baqarah, and then he prayed An-Nisa. So this is different to the order of, and also it is authentic hadith. If you recite, if you read the book of Shaykh al-Albani, Sifatul Salat, there are about 10 surahs that the Prophet used to recite in the first rak'ah, and then the previous one he would recite in the second rak'ah, such as وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَى, and then وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا, and a number of surahs he wrote, which indicates. But either way, alhamdulillah, it's permissible to recite it in a different order in the salah. What is not permissible is to recite from the same surah. You cannot pray in the first surah, آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون, sorry, in the first rak'ah, and then in the second rak'ah you recite Ayat al-Kursi. No, this is not acceptable. The number of surahs is 113, and some say 114. Where is the difference? At-Tawbah and Al-Anfal. But the majority of Muslims all agree that it is a separate surah. And not having Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim due to the fact that it is a surah that came to exploit the hypocrites. So it should not be included with mercy. The names of the surahs are given mostly, okay, but we went through this. The Quran is divided into four parts. And these division, there are hadiths regarding it. It's divided regarding the Tawal. And they are the surahs from Al-Baqarah to At-Tawbah. And then you have Al-Mi'in that are close to 200 or less. And this goes from Yunus to Fatir. And the Mathani from Yasin to Hujarat. And Al-Mufassal from Hujarat downwards. And this is how they used to recite it. Other way of dividing it, the companions used to divide it by 7 surahs, 9 surahs, 11 surahs, and 13 surahs. So this is the way they used to divide it by, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11 surahs, and etc. The beginning of surahs. There are surahs that are begun with the disjointed letters. And you know these surahs, we don't have to mention them. The disjointed letters are equal to half of the Arabic alphabet. What does it mean? You can read maybe 20 or 30 different opinion of scholars. All are baseless. The only thing we believe, it is a challenge from Allah to the Arabs. The Arabs themselves, no one from Quraysh, from the Baghdad, says, what is Alif Lam Mim? What is this? Nobody said this. Which meant that it was understood by them to be a form of challenge or a form of beginning the surah. But to someone to say Alif Lam Mim, Allah, Jibreel, Muhammad. Some say, An Allah Alim. And you have lots of interpretation, are all baseless. One would say, Yasin is the name of the Prophet ﷺ. Taha. And they say, Taha is the Prophet. No, all of this is baseless. They are baseless. They are not the name of the Prophet ﷺ. They are disjointed letters. Some surahs start with Alhamdulillah, praising Allah Azza wa Jal, as mentioned. Some surahs begin with a call. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, such as Hujurat, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tuqaddimu bayna yaday Allahi wa rasulihi wa attaqullah. Some surahs begin with a statement or a fact. Qad aflaha al-mu'minun. What do you want us to do? No, I'm stating a fact. Those who believe have prospered, they have succeeded. This is a fact or a statement. Some surahs, as we mentioned, begin with an oath. والعصر والفجر والشمس وضحاها, etc. Some surahs begin with a condition. إذا جاءك المنافقون قالوا نشهد إنك لرسول الله والله يعلم إنك لرسوله والله يشهد إن المنافقين لكاذبون. If they come to you, Allah عز وجل approves that you are His messenger, but He approves that they are liars. Likewise, إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح, if the victory and the help of Allah comes, this will happen. So you ask Allah for forgiveness and so on. Some surahs begin with a command. اقرأ, this is an order, an instruction. And some surahs begin with a question. And Allah is asking? Is Allah asking? Allah Azza wa Jalla never asks. But this form of question either to raise your attention and awareness. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية? Did you receive news about the day of judgment where it will cover the minds of the people? Allah knows that He got this news, but He wants to raise the attention and awareness of people where Allah does not ask. He either reprimands people by asking them, don't you believe? He's not asking. He's saying, because you don't believe, I will show you. So He's punishing them. But He never asked because Azza wa Jal knows everything that is happening. And it could be an invocation. تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ. It's cursing Abu Lahab for doing this. And also can be a reason or a cause. And they give a reference of لِإِلَافِ قُرَيْشٍ إِلَافِهِمْ رِحْلَةَ الشَّتَاءِ وَالصَّيْفِ فَلْيَعْبُدُ. This is why they should do this. This is also... Okay, final. Disjointed letters, we went through this. Allah knows the meaning. Some of them say that it's names of Allah. Some of them say that Allah swore by them. It's a form of oath. And some of them, they say it's acronyms. The meaning is Ana, Allah, Jibreel, Muhammad. It's short for few forms. And all of this is not true. Some say that this is the name of the Quran. And again, no evidence. Names of the surah. This is possible, but we have a number of surahs that start with Alif Lam Ra. We have a problem. Alif Lam Mim. So what would you say? Alif Lam Mim number one, Alif Lam Mim number two. This is not valid. Some of them say that it is to attract attention. And this can be. But it cannot be the main and only reason. The challenge to Arabs also can be. But we don't have the specific dalil to say this is the one. It can be a combination of three or four of them. We do not have this. And Allah knows best. Wallahu a'lam.
الحمد لله رب العالمين صلى الله وسلم وبارك على عبده ورسوله نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد, last session we did not take any questions, did we? Should we? So,
brothers and sisters, if you have any questions of yesterday, you can just write it down. We can take a few questions, inshallah. The question, in which harf was the Quran preserved at the time of the Prophet? Is that harf still there?
This will come, inshallah, to discuss today.
The question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that He revealed the dhikr and He will preserve it. Does dhikr include sunnah also?
Yes, the answer is yes. The sunnah is included in the terminology al-dhikr, because Allah says, وَنَزَّلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, which translates to that we have revealed to you al-dhikr, so that you could clarify to the people what was revealed to them. What was revealed to them? The Quran. Then what is meant by the dhikr that was revealed to you prior to that, which is the sunnah? And also Allah says, وَذْكُرْنَا مَا يُتْلَى فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. Allah is talking to or addressing the wives of the Prophet ﷺ by saying that you should recite, you should mention the verses of Allah that are being recited in your house, which is Quran, and al-hikmah, which is the wisdom of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that is clarifying, that is explaining these verses of the Quran. Therefore, the dhikr is both. It is the Quran and it is also the sunnah. And you cannot understand the Quran fully without the sunnah. It explains it. It also completes some of the rulings of it. And this goes beyond saying, if we would like to elaborate on the importance of the sunnah, it goes without saying in Surah An-Nisa, where Allah Azza wa Jal tells us and lists to us the types of women we are not allowed to marry, and this is known as mahram. So, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ وَبَنَاتُكُمْ وَأَخَوَاتُكُمْ, and it goes on and lists. So, nowhere in the Quran it says that a man cannot marry a woman and her aunt. But the sunnah comes with this. So if someone says it's not mentioned in the Quran, no one would approve of it, because the sunnah, the Prophet forbade us from joining between a woman and her aunt, whether paternal or maternal, from her mother's side or from her father's side. All of this is forbidden. And the list is too long. Anyone who reads the Quran and knows the sunnah knows that they go side by side.
Quran was revealed to Prophet at the age of 40. But before that also he used to offer salah. What he used to recite prior to revelation of Quran in his salah?
The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did not offer salah before he was revealed to. When he was first prophesied, alayhi salatu wasalam, and he became a prophet and a messenger, he did not pray until Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the Fatiha, and then he prayed with the Fatiha and with whatever Quran he had. Before he became a prophet or a messenger, before the age of 40, he used to go to Ghar Hira to contemplate, to think.